Hello, my name's Mike. I'm a psychotherapist. I grew up in an alcoholic home. I remember my grandfather when I was little drinking shaving lotion, aqua velva, vanilla extract. My dad was also an extreme alcoholic. We rarely saw him because he was generally out drinking. There was always this little voice in the back of my brain. I'm not going to be my father, and I'm not going to be like my grandfather. I'm not going to be the town drunk. At 45, I had a thriving practice. We had a beautiful home. We had a great life. I loved being a father. I remember starting to kind of hide drinks. Have booze in my water bottle, even like a milk carton. I'd have booze in the toilet tank. It was just starting to just fall apart. And even the boys would come up, "Dad, I'll quit drinking with you. We can do this together." All I was thinking about is, I really need a drink. I called my oldest son and I said, "I want to talk to you." I was trying to do this amends thing once again, and he was done. And he just said, "Dad, I love you."
"But I can't do this anymore," he said. "I have to pretend that, you know, that you're not alive or something, that you're dead." "So we're not going to have any more contact." And he didn't.
Go down the ditches along the highways, picking bottles, cash them in. Tried panhandling. I started a detox. And I needed a drink badly. I pulled out my laptop. It's a brand new laptop. I just said, "Anybody want to buy a laptop?" And finally, one guy says, "I'll give you $20 for it." Took the $20 and bought four beer. It's called the couch of willingness. And that couch was just, it stunk of piss and puke, and you stay there until, you know, you can kind of convince the people around the place that you're going to surrender to the program. The worst thing that happened in there was the suicide, when Harold hung himself. There was a rusty old child's swing there, and he was hanging from that. And I just said, you know, I have to get out of here. But I had nowhere to go. "Ah, so I hear you tried to off yourself." He says, "You know, listen, you want to fucking off yourself? Let's go. I'll buy the rope for you. I'll drive you to the fucking bridge." "Can't even do that right." The first year of getting sober was probably one of the hardest years of my life. A year's a long time when the things the most important to you in life aren't in your life anymore.
Hi, welcome. This is the Addiction Show. I'm so pleased to announce this is our full season 2. I am the host, Shira Goldberg. Just wanted to say a quick thank you to all of our subscribers and people that are sending comments and suggestions. It's always helpful and nice to connect with people that are watching. So thanks a lot. Today I have with me, usually I have one guest, but these two come in a pair, and what a pair we have.
And what a pair.
They are co-authors and partners in life of the book, The Couch of Willingness. They are actually standing in front of a great banner, which I really love that. Michael Pond is a psychotherapist in the Vancouver, British Columbia area, and Maureen Palmer has an extensive background in journalism, and she was over at the Canadian Broadcasting Corporation for many years, and now she is branched out on her own, and she's quite a successful film / documentarian, so I'm super honored to have you on the show. So welcome.
Thank you.
Thank you, Shira. Good to be here.
I'm so glad you are, and that it's working out, and you are so busy this summer. So let's just jump right in. So, Michael, tell us when you first realized you had a drinking problem.
Well, sure. I think I probably knew at some level all along that I had a problem. I had a predisposition. But I remember one year we were up in the mountain, Apex Mountain, which was close to our town, and we were snowboarding away. It was me and my sons and a bunch of buddies. And then I remember, you know, I slipped away and I went into the trees and I had a Mickey of vodka stuck inside my snow jacket. And I looked around, make sure nobody was watching, and then I would take a couple of swigs out of my flask. Now, you know, people do that, I think, maybe, but I knew that for me it wasn't about just having a little shot on the mountain. I knew it was about fulfilling some kind of, uncomfortableness. And then right after that, my oldest son was 15, and he said, "Dad, I'm getting a little bit worried about your drinking." You know, and we had a very, very open relationship, and I really took that to heart. And I think that's when it first kind of clicked for me.
Oh, that's definitely a bitter pill to swallow when you're hearing it from your son.
Yes, it is.
So like I mentioned in the introduction, you are an accomplished psychotherapist in private practice. So how did a trained professional like yourself end up in a rundown recovery home for addicts?
Well, as my drinking progressed and into the middle, late 2007, my drinking had really gotten terrible, and I'd actually left the house, and I was coming into work, you know, still semi-loaded, and by the end, I'd lost pretty well everything I had in my hometown where I had my practice.
Didn't you walk one day and find 4 resignations on your desk?
And that's what happened. I showed up at work. I'd been away on a binge for about 5 days, and I walked in, and I had 4 resignations on my desk, and that was all my staff basically saying they'd had enough. And
then when you had lost your staff pretty well, you lost your clients too, and you had no money, and you ended up on a Greyhound bus.
Yeah, I'd met a woman, and she was from Vancouver, and I jumped on this Greyhound bus. I don't even remember getting on the bus. I was so loaded, and I was blacked out. And all I remember is the bus driver coming in the back, waking me up, and he said, at the end of the line, mister, you're going to have to get out. And I was in the downtown east side of Vancouver, which is a very infamous skid row.
It definitely is.
Then he sold his laptop for $20 to buy his last 4 beer, made his way to what is a fairly recreational area in British Columbia called White Rock. It was the middle of a bitter snowstorm, and we hardly ever get them. He stole a bottle of Glenfiddich from a fairly high-end restaurant and passed out on the beach. Ended up going to an AA meeting the next morning and was said, "Why don't you come to this recovery home with us, buddy?" That's where he ended up on something called the Couch of Willingness, which is a place where you had to stay until the guy who ran that house believed that you admitted enough that you were powerless over alcohol.
And that's why it was called the Couch of Willingness. It kind of, that name had kind of been adopted over the years, I think, and And I had to surrender, and I stayed on that couch for a couple of weeks the first time.
And it stank of piss, of puke, vomit, you name it, because a lot of guys had detoxed on that couch.
I am estimated it might have been about 600-700 guys had detoxed on that couch over the years.
And you had to sleep on it. Oh, my God.
I had to live on it. You had to stay on that couch, right, day and night.
But there's also a dual meaning with the title. So what's the flip side of that?
Well, being a therapist, a psychotherapist, and, you know, having the psychotherapy couch, and I actually had one in my office. It was a love seat, but a big one. So, you know, it was a play on words, and we just thought it was a good title.
The double meaning. I also think the book has almost a duality to it, because on the one hand, it's the experience of Mike the drunk, but it's seen through the eyes of Mike the therapist. So at every level, while he's falling and decompensating, he can look at himself with a clinical eye. And
yeah, I was doing clinical assessments on myself because I knew what was happening to me. I knew that I was slipping and going deeper. And with sleep deprivation, I wasn't sleeping at all. And probably after the 2 weeks of sleep deprivation, I started to hear voices, and I started to get extremely paranoid. And that's not a nice place to be.
Your book, it really shows the devolution, I guess. I don't know what the right word is, but just your history of where you were to how you ended up on this couch. And as someone who's interested in being a psychotherapist myself, I really appreciated the it was kind of almost painfully relevant, I guess, that you included progress notes throughout your book. So it really showed, and you did it on a scale of where you thought you were in certain capacities, and you could really see you were pretty much going downhill.
Yeah, that's the standardized DSM, Diagnostic and Statistical Manual assessment, clinical assessment. And always at the end, there's a global assessment of functioning, and it's on a scale of 0 to 100.
Yeah. But I think what Mike realized, the more he sank down, the deeper his, you know, destruction was, the worse treatment options were available to him. And he just got sicker and sicker, and he realized how much the system was not working for him.
Mm-hmm. And that's a really important component of the book, because, I mean, it's important enough to be a part of the title. You didn't have a lot of options because you were technically and legally destitute. But I have to ask you, why didn't you ask your family for help?
You know, pride, for one thing, initially. And then when I got really, really desperate, by the time, you know, I was at that point and asking for help, my family and friends were exhausted and had enough. So anytime I would ask for any kind of financial help or support in any way, it just didn't come. And so I found out what it's like to be penniless and broke, you know, on the streets and have to rely on welfare.
Yeah, here's a guy who you know, could think nothing of dropping $100 for lunch, picking up empties along Highway 1, which is the Trans-Canada Highway. When he finally got a job back as a nurse, he had no money to get to work. He had no money for bus fare. So there he was picking up bottles.
The young fellow and I, it was another fellow from a part of Canada where I'm from, New Brunswick, and we kind of clicked, became good friends. And we'd go walk along the ditches picking bottles and cans, and that's how I got the money to get bus passes to get to that job.
It got so bad, the lack of money, when he actually got offered the job and he relapsed the first time, this is to the credit of the hospital and the union, they gave him his job back with conditions that he submit to medical monitoring, random urinalysis, but that cost like
$1,400. $1,400 to start.
He had to make a Faustian pact with somebody else in the house to give him that money, because nobody, no one in his family would trust him enough to believe that that money was actually going to go to that.
Yeah, I actually called my mother, and I called my father and my stepmom and various people, and they just weren't going to do it for obviously their reasons that made a lot of sense to them. But I was desperate. I really did need a leg up, you know. I was at that stage where I knew I'm in big trouble here and I need a leg up. But people just weren't hearing it because there'd been so many lies and so much manipulation.
I'm glad you're speaking honestly about it, because there's always reasons why families just they can't help anymore, because they're getting sucked into this undertow of addiction, and they really
that. I understood what that. Yeah, I understood what that was about because, you know, I went through it with my father, you know, as the oldest son, and my younger brother who really succumbed early and was highly addicted when I was still, you know, high functioning, and he would do that to me all the time.
You know, Taylor, Mike's oldest son, he was almost his guardian when mm-hmm. the drinking got to be really bad. He would show up, just his timing was beautiful. He'd show up and take his car keys before he could go out and do damage. And the last time almost that you and Taylor spoke, he threw the keys back because the burden of looking after Dad just got to be too much to bear. And they didn't talk for 2 years.
Taylor, my oldest son, you know, in the initial stages, you know, he'd come and I'd be withdrawing. I'd be on the bed so sick. And he'd come and he'd show up, and one time he stayed with me for 2 days and sat at the foot of my bed and got me water and Tylenol, and, you know, it's just really...
It's very hard to actually put your child in that position and then live with the knowledge you did that. The good thing is, I mean, there's a happy ending here. Taylor is very much now in Mike's life, and it's really, it's, I think, one of the many gifts of just... staying sober, and he had to wait a long time before that phone rang, and it was Taylor. I mean, that the day that that happened is the day that actually Mike believed that life was going to get better again, and that was almost a year of sobriety, right?
Yeah, I was over a year sober by then, and it was my birthday, and the phone rang, and I recognized his number, and I went, and like my heart just stopped, and I was like, oh my goodness, it's Tay.
Your book is, I see you getting a little choked up. I have to chime in here. When I was reading the book, it was so emotional. It was like a major motion movie. And I had to put the book down, and I felt your pain and your plight and all of the other characters in the book, and especially that one part in the book that you just shared earlier about you having to... your friend offering, who's also in this disgusting, dilapidated situation that's being called a treatment center or a safe house or whatever you call them.
Recovery houses, yeah, we call them.
Yeah, I mean, and to see that you might have a chance out there in the world to get it back together, and he's the one who offered you his help to collect the cans so you could get the bus fare, so you could get to work.
Well, that the first day that I had to go for the interview, all the guys, the young guys in particular, knows, I think they saw me as a bit of a father figure, right? And I know I relate well to young men because, you know, I have three sons. I'm a big kid at heart anyway. But you know, they sat me down and they gave me the old jailhouse haircut. And one of the guys,
prescient.
One of the guys gave me... you know, his nice golf shirt that he had, and another guy lent me his nice shoes, his uncle's shoes, and, you know, and they got me all ready, basically, and got me off to this interview, and when I got back, I got the interview, when I got back, they were all cheering, and it was pretty cool.
And, you know, he got to the interview, but he didn't have money to get back. He walked 10 miles.
Oh, yeah, I forgot
that. Back to that recovery house.
The guy that ran the recovery house, he was the one that drove the van, that transported us to everywhere, and... The guy said, you know, we've got to go get him, Carl. And he says, I'm not fucking going to get him. He's, you know, he's on his own, man. I had to walk. Yeah, it was over. It was almost 12 miles back from that hospital.
But that was not a walk of shame. That was a walk of victory.
No, I was strutting along, man. I was full of it.
You know, I don't think, sure, that we can play up too much how bad it was in some of those homes. Like, that very first day that Mike was actually back on the job, he's shaving and a rat falls on his head. You know, he wakes up in the middle of the night, 2 or 3 in the morning, two young other clients of the house, holding a knife to his throat, demanding a blowjob.
It was a camo hunting buck knife, and he held it to my throat.
He wakes up another morning, and it's very, you know, it's early January, it's a very depressing time here in the Lower Mainland, lots of rain. A young man has hanged himself outside on the swings. Mike cut him down as an ex-nurse. He has a lot of experience, and tried to revive him and couldn't. And it just, I think some of those stories, when he told me them, and we have a system in BC where we have hundreds of these houses, we knew that's one of the reasons why we had to write the book, because nobody, no young man should be hanging himself from a swing because he's losing a battle with addiction.
Yeah, in a care facility. I mean, and that was the second one in a period of 5 weeks.
was this the same guy, who was running this treatment center that told you, because you were really looking like hell, quite frankly, and he said he threatened to take a picture of you and send it to your son?
Yeah. Yeah, he came out. I was sitting at the table, and I just got off the streets, and I was a mess. I was a mess, psychotic, and anyway, you can imagine what I looked like. And he came out around the corner with his camera, big Canon camera, and took a picture of me, and he started to say, look at you, aren't you a fucking sight to see, you know? I'm going to send this to your sons.
And then when Mike was quite suicidal there for a period, and this same man said, fine, come on, you want to off yourself? I'll drive you a Canadian Tire, which is like, you know, Home Depot. Let's go buy the rope. I'll drive you to the bridge. You can off yourself. Can't even do that right, can you, buddy? And I think, when I think of the number of people who are depressed in these places, and actually, that's one of the key issues, right? It's not just addiction quite often. It's a
It's concurrent.
Yeah,
Canada, we call it concurrent disorder.
There's a mental health issue as well, right? So to tell somebody who's feeling that way that is like, you should get your license yanked for that, buddy.
Yeah.
Did they even have a license?
What they have is a kind of a business license, go figure. And then there's another, all they have to do is kind of go and register as a nonprofit society, right? And then if they, you know, as long as they have a board of directors and they need minimum four, make a quorum for a board, and that's it. Then you're ready to go, and here the Ministry for Housing and Development will recognize that. So we all had to turn over our welfare checks to the house manager. So
I'm glad you're bringing that up. You were working with $660 a month. How much did you have to turn over to this?
Well, it was actually $610.
Oh, $610, and, okay. Yeah,
and I had to turn over $550. So I had $60. I had $60 a month, and thank God I was 55 because I got the seniors discount on coffee at McDonald's. So I could afford, you know, a 69-cent coffee and maybe get one a day with that money. It was I learned a lot about what happens when you start falling down that each rung, you know, of the socioeconomic ladder and what kind of treatment and. You know, we always go on about the social welfare cases and they're sucking the system and they're parasites. Well, try living it. I mean, you'll find out it's far from that.
I've always made the suggestion to any politician who's thinking along the similar mindset. I was like, why don't you just try to live this way for a month and then come talk to me?
Be a single mom with a couple of children.
Yeah, be a single mom on food stamps and tell me how easy it is to prepare some nutritious meals and whatever, you know, the bare minimal that they get every month. I mean, it's socially just a travesty. But for you to be able to have the background that you've had, you were a psychiatric nurse before you became a psychotherapist. And, I mean, a lot of people don't come from this where they have something like that to fall back on and out of.
I was a rare beast in that world. And it shocked a lot of the guys that were there because, you know, this guy that comes from, you know, quite a high level and successful life to have me in the midst of these fellows.
I think that's why one of the reasons why we wanted to write the book, Shira, like not a lot of people of Mike's caliber and stature who have that level of education and masters ever end up in those places. So who else is going to tell their story? So one of the things really important was to give those people a voice. And some of those guys, I mean, you know, there were heroes in the strangest of places and there were demons in the strangest of places, right? Not all the demons were where you'd expect them to be.
No.
You've been sober now for 5 years. You met Maureen right at the end of your first sober year. Tell us how you guys met. This is so awesome.
Well, I was back working in an adolescent psychiatric unit. It was actually a unit like the kind of unit that I managed 20 years prior when I was a head nurse in a psych unit. Anyway, I was back there working because that's the only place I could get work as a frontline nurse, and I, all the young people that worked there, they were all kind of my kids' age. They were looking at me one day and they went, you know what, Mike, you need a woman, man. You need a lady in your life. You know, you're still a good-looking guy, you know. So They put me on plenty of fish.
Which you hadn't even heard of.
I didn't know what the hell it was. What's that? And, well, I went in the morning, the night shift had put me on plenty of fish. And I went, and they were telling me all about it. Well, what the hell is plenty of fish? Then they started explaining it to me, and I'm going,
And then at lunch hour, all the pings start coming in from all the women. Oh. Like, he's a track man and, like, fresh meat, right? A new guy on plenty of fish.
And they put on their successful psychotherapist.
And then I think you had about 13 dates, and they were all like, when they found out a little bit of the story, yeah. It's like, oh, well, this wouldn't work out. I like my wine too much, that kind of stuff.
I get, as soon as they find out that I was an alcoholic or whatever, right, and what's going on in my life, even just the tiniest little bit, oh, I don't date men under 5'10". I don't think it's really fair, you know, that I'm going to be enjoying my wine in front of you, so I don't think we should see each other anymore. Okay?
So I was date number 14, and I met him downtown, and he showed up on the SkyTrain, which is like a subway, and he ordered, I think, cranberry juice, and right away I went, oh.
Cranberry and soda.
What's going on here? And he was very honest from the very beginning, and I was really intrigued by the honesty, and I thought he was cute. And we had another date, and on the second and third date, he unpeeled, I'd say, 3/4 of the layers of that onion. And I went, oh my God, this is the best story I've ever heard in my life. Like, the storyteller part of me went, hey buddy, I don't know if I'm going to date you for much longer, but we're going to write a book together. And we stuck together, and I think the book and the relationship grew together. We realized that that book was such a partnership, and it was so hard sometimes, and we both wanted it so badly. We had to sort of lead with our best selves. We had to kind of learn things and apologize and make concessions and be much more amenable, because if either of us didn't work out, then we didn't get a book.
You know, writing that book, actually, I see it now as a therapeutic tool. You know, it was a therapeutic tool for me, because writing it, I know, really, really healed me. And us writing it together took us through some pretty hard times. I mean, try living with a guy just 1 year sober, right, that has nothing. By then, I'd lost everything. Yeah. In fact, I was $100,000 in debt.
And he had like one, what do we say, a stick of furniture? He had a bed in an empty apartment. And I didn't tell any of my friends or my family about the situation. And my mom meets Mike. And then a few days later, she says, I think I like that Mike Pond, but I think he has a secret.
Oh, she loves me now, though.
Yeah. And my friends, you know, as they started hearing the story, they'd gotten to know Mike a bit, quite a bit. Like, it was really about 6 months before we started revealing things. And then people started very much to be on his side.
Yeah. Yeah, I made a whole new set of friends, a whole new social world, because I'd pretty well lost, you know, I de-peopled completely. I didn't have anybody left, really.
Yeah, and I think that one of the reasons why he got involved in such a self-destructive relationship in the book with another woman who's a very hard drinker, was they had deep people together. They only had each other. And Mike says he believes a lot of what brings people back to drinking isn't the drinking, it's the loneliness. Mm-hmm. So,
yeah, the loneliness is just, it's, you know, it's deep despair. I'm not a depressive person. I've never been diagnosed with clinical depression. But, you know, when you go through the situation I went through and what I put my family through, and you add all that up together with all the stressors and the losses, you know, I had a severe clinical depression, and God knows I know what that feels like now.
Especially when you ended up going to prison. Yeah, you had to serve 3 weeks for some drunk driving offenses. And I mean, for a man of that stature to fall that far and to be actually in the system, Mike actually started his career in the system working in
juvenile detention, yeah.
Yeah, and there he is going to prison and actually finding out, like, almost again using that as a lab, that experience, that 3/4 of the people, minimum security, are in there because of addiction-related offenses. Yet another reason why we wanted to write the book, because we've criminalized addiction, and so much of it is, it needs a medical and a social solution and an education solution, but not a criminal one.
Oh, there you are, okay.
Did you lose us?
Yeah, I just lost the last part.
Well, I think, you know, that's probably all the soapboxing we need anyway.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, but it's just really amazing how you're able to put everything that happened, and also there was even a comment in the book just how accurate your memory. Your ex-wife said that she couldn't believe you actually remembered some of these things because of just the level of of despair you were in, and the psychosis, and the, all of the drinking. I mean, it really does some damage to your brain. So,
we met with Rhonda, my ex-wife, Rhonda. And we gave her one of the manuscripts, the final manuscripts for her to read and make sure that she was okay with everything, and she was fine.
And your boys too.
And my boys and my sons as well, and anybody else that was mentioned in the book that we've kept their names and their identities. And we sat down for coffee, and she just looked at me and she said, "Mike, I don't know how you remembered all that stuff." She said, "You were so out of it." Mm-hmm. You know, and I was out of it, but for some reason, and she said, you were very accurate.
You know, to Rhonda's credit, at the book launch here in Vancouver back in May, a lot of people, both sides of our families, and lots of friends, and people from pretty well every part of the socioeconomic ladder, including some guys still in recovery houses, were there. But Rhonda stood up at the end and said, "I need to say something." And she looked at the room and she said, "You know, forgiveness can't change the past, but it can change the future."
Wow.
And, you know, it was like such element of grace because she had lived through hell, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Very healing. This whole process has been very healing.
Well, it's,
I don't know if I'd recommend everybody write a book, but...
Yeah, that was what... that leads very well into my next question. Even as a psychotherapist, where you can kind of distance yourself and get more clinical about it and see your descent into despair and destruction. Just as a human, how does that affect you even today, talking about these certain, because I think for most people that would experience what you've experienced would be considered survivors. And there's a lot of people that are in their destructive addictions and they end up suffering from post-traumatic stress disorder because of all of the suffering that they, that they put themselves in these situations. But you know, that I would imagine would have long-term effects. So you know, earlier you were tearing up a little bit. I mean, it seems like it still is hard for you to talk about certain aspects.
Well, certain aspects are still emotional because of the impact mostly it had on my family. You know, if I was to have one, I had lots of regret, not so many anymore, but because I've healed a lot of them. But the one was what the drinking did to my family, what it did to my children, and what it did to their mother, and you know, my mother, and all the family. When I look back at that piece, you know, I still feel sad.
You've done a lot of making amends of the financial kind, like pretty well paying back everybody, including the guy who gave him the money for the medical monitoring,
yeah.
Even the bottle of scotch that he stole from the high-end restaurant.
That was
back there. It's not so easy to make amends for losing huge parts of your childhood, right? The boys, right. Especially the youngest, didn't have his dad at, you know, pretty crucial times in his life.
And all I can do for them, and we continue to do it, and it just gets better and better and better, is just to just keep doing the right thing. And you know, the men's process for me is behavior. It's what am I doing, right? Not what am I saying, or what, you know, saying I'm sorry over and over and over again. It's they just need to see and watch. And I need to model, you know, the integrity and that they can trust me again, you know. That I'll be there for them.
And it took them a long time. I think it was at least 2 years before there was a... In that first year, they didn't come around very much. They just kept watching.
Mm-hmm.
They expected to be disappointed, I think.
Yeah, they were just waiting for the next time for the hammer to hit again, right? So, and I understand that. Like, you know, this is the irony of this as well, is I grew up with that. You know, I had a father that was a raging alcoholic, and I know what that feels like. And so that's, I think, also, it probably kicks into some of my own personal stuff of my childhood. Because I would vow, I'm never going to do that, right? I'm never going to be that guy and do that to my children. Well, I did. But we're also showing how you can heal that, how you can mend that, and how it can even make us stronger and more resilient and more courageous. And it's a real, I believe it's a real strengthening and a building of character.
And I, we're wrapping up, but I wanted to ask you a question that has come up a lot. Could your family have done anything different to change your destruction?
I believe so. I do. You know, having learned what I've learned, and I was an expert myself, a professional. You know, I've looked at some of these newer models through the craft models, community reinforcement and family training, and the Center for Motivation and Change. You know, some of these other models that really look at the family and how important it is to work with the family, even in, you know, with the substance user, you know, out of that therapeutic situation, and how that family. And I think that if my ex and my sons and maybe, you know, other close family members were involved in something like craft, you know, 10 years ago, mm-hmm. we wouldn't have a book.
Just one final thing. I do think that Michael always says now that family doctors really need to be as well-educated as possible in the state of the art in terms of treatment, and because that's where people often end up going first, right? And if the family doctors really know how to help the family and point to AA by all means, but point to other things as well, because I just think some people, AA doesn't, it's not right for them, it doesn't work for them, and then they feel like, oh, there's nothing else. We now know there are other things. Everybody needs to know that.
Yeah,
I love where we're going. Craft, because of people like you and like me, is becoming more people. There's just more of a sense of awareness, and I think the hardest part for family members is they just don't know what to do. Turn left, turn right. It's up, it's down, it's in and out. So,
well, and then they just get exhausted. They get mentally, emotionally exhausted.
And I also think, actually, that they also get depeopled. Like, yes. If you've got a heart attack or a cancer in the family, the casseroles come flowing to the house. You got an alcoholic husband, people kind of disappear.
Nobody wants to come to that house. And I think that was hard. That was hard for my ex-wife, you know, because we were very social. We were Grand Central Station in our neighborhood, and we always had a bunch of kids hanging out, and we had a boat on the lake. And you know, we were a fun place to be. And so for her to have to, you know, change all that was really, really difficult. You know, it would have been a very big sacrifice.
Well, I love what you've done together. The collaboration really, it really shined through in the book, and that you're really able to touch so many different types of people through your book and sharing your story. And it just shows people that it's a long, hard battle back, but it's possible. And I really appreciate your honesty and your integrity, both of you. So we're going to put up all of your links where they can buy the book, and you are currently on this book tour. Every time I talk to you, you're bouncing around to a different park.
I know. Yeah, it's a holiday. They've been nice. The last one in Penticton was awesome. A lot of old friends and old clients of mine showed up, and I got lots of hugs and lots of tears. It was really good. It was really nice.
Well, thank you so much, Maureen Palmer and Michael Pond. We will check back with you, and we will definitely include all of your links. And if anyone's interested in just keeping up with this dynamic duo, you can check out their website, and I'm sure all of their information is as updated as they can in their journeys.
So people to watch the book trailer too.
Oh yeah, I'm gonna put the link up on the website and also on the YouTube channel. It's super great, and I think everyone's gonna kind of take some liberty and copycat. This is such an empowering story. It's not just for people with. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Shira.